I was turning the final bend on the quarter mile track by our high school. 200 yards to go. It had been a long race, not just the one of that day, but the months leading up to it. It was my first year in cross country. I had decided to do cross country because while I had been a soccer player, I had never been especially accurate at kicking. I had never been especially good at watching the plays develop or predicting how things were going to go, but I could run both halves without a break. And so someone said, you should be in cross country. So soccer was in the fall, cross country was in the spring, so I signed up for cross country. The first practice was rigorous. More rigorous than I'd ever been in before. And the day of, I was tired, but the next day, I hurt so badly. Those steps you use to get in and out of a school bus are just a little bit taller than the usual steps. And not only going in the bus, but coming back out, especially, having to lower myself down one step at a time. I felt my muscles screaming in agony. I was thinking to myself, this is what it'll feel like when I'm 90. We got past that initial set of pain and got into the rhythm of the cross-country season, and I discovered that cross-country running is not like running a marathon or a truly long-distance run, because it's exactly 5K, it's 3.1 miles. And so what you have to do is learn to pace yourself in such a way that it's a little bit like long-distance running, because you need to be able to sprint at the end, so you need to pace yourself out, you don't go flat out the whole time. But you also don't go quite as slow as you do on a truly long distance run. You have to learn to stretch your stride out and push yourself to just the edge of what it is for, what for you is your long distance run stride. So you have a little bit of energy left to push at the end. And I had done this run dozens of times over the course of the season. In my high school, there was a little barn down the road, and if you ran down to the barn, around the barn, back from the barn, and did two laps around the high school track, it was exactly 5 kilometers. I knew this particular run very, very well, and thought I had paced myself perfectly, because this was the practice that would determine who was on the team that was going to the state championships. The top five runners would make it. As we rounded the final curve, I had 200 yards left to run, and that's when you pour it on to the best of your ability. And there was only one person ahead of me. And as I laid into that stride, I could see the distance closing, and I thought, I'm gonna make it, I'm gonna make it, I'm gonna make it. And then I started to notice on the sides of my vision, other people running just as fast, and maybe faster than I was. So I pushed even a little bit harder. I kept pushing and I kept pushing. I thought, what am I doing? What do I got? I got to go. I got to go. And then in the final 50 yards, five people passed me. So that in the end, after all the effort of an entire season, I came in seventh. As I gasped for breath, it was nothing compared to the pain inside. The pain of feeling like I failed despite my best effort. I imagine that's somewhat how the disciples are feeling in today's reading from the Gospel. In fact, this story occurs in the Gospel of Mark at the end of three sequences where they have made one big failure after another. One of the alternate readings for today, the alternate Gospel readings, is where Jesus says to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." And all Peter is trying to do is say, "No, Lord, we're not letting you go to Jerusalem where they're going to kill you." He was trying to show his love for Jesus. And Jesus smacks him down and says, "Get behind me, Satan." What a blow. What a kick in the stomach. Have you ever felt that way? Have you ever felt just kicked in the gut by failure? Have you ever worked your hardest and yet your hardest wasn't good enough? Mustn't that have been how Peter felt? They've been commissioned to go forth and cast out demons, and they can't do it. Peter had, at this point in the story, left home. He left his regular job. He had no ability left to make it. He was following around an itinerant preacher who was the son of a carpenter. He had no pedigree. He wasn't a recognized teacher of the law. He surely must have been met with ridicule for leaving his fishing nets and following this man. But then as the story progresses and we start to get to this point, people are paying attention to Jesus, and now we go from ridicule to danger. Jesus is gaining the attention of the authorities. So people are coming to contest his authority. Increasingly, it becomes a dangerous proposition to follow Jesus. Peter has done all this for love of the man he's following around and believes to be the chosen one of God. And in fact, as this story begins, they have just come from the mountain of the Transfiguration. Peter has watched as Jesus was transfigured before them, and Moses and Elijah show up. They see the glory of God. They're with the glory of God. They're with God himself on that mountain. And Peter has offered his most spectacular idea. Let's build a couple of houses and stay right here, God. It's so great where we are. And this too was rejected by Jesus. Kicked in the gut. Failing. We've all been there. What Peter and all the disciples had to learn and will learn as the story continues and leads its way ever from this point in the gospel on towards Jerusalem. They learn tonight in today's reading that they have a lot to learn about the ways of God. What they will learn as they journey to Jerusalem is that until they can fully embrace the cross, they don't know the ways of God. Until they know that his power is made perfect in weakness, they do not know the ways of God. We too, on our journey, have to learn this. We cling to the old rugged cross, but too often, we want to avoid our own cross, the one Jesus tells us we must shoulder and follow after. We often avoid applying the hard words of Jesus to our lives and go straight for the ones that give us comfort. Hard words like we heard in the book of James today about paying more attention to our speech than our diet. Exhortations to spend time not just learning about God or speaking about God, but speaking to God and letting him speak to us so that we and those around us might be freed from the influence of evil. Prayer alone, Jesus says, can drive out this kind. And in the end, speak to God rather than about him is the ultimate lesson of the book of Job, the book on suffering. We often avoid hearing that we have a lot left to learn. Rather, as a way that Lutherans commit ourselves, we proclaim this truth and we commit ourselves to learning more about the ways of God once a year. We set ourselves together, proclaiming Christ as Savior by recommitting ourselves to his role as teacher, applying the lessons to our lives that he teaches, no matter how hard they hurt or make us feel like we've been kicked in the gut. Dedicating ourselves to learning more about God. And yes, that's theology and the Bible and doctrine. But also to learn more about our ways with God. Just another word for discipleship. When in the wake of that defeat in cross country, and when I was 16 years old, when I spent time thinking about what had gotten me to that moment, as I spent time talking with some of the senior members of the team, with my coaches, as I considered whether I was going to go out for it again next year, what I discovered was not a flaw in my technique, but a flaw in myself. It's that I had to run with more heart. I had to more wholeheartedly give myself to the moment. Less analysis, more sweat. Rally Day is about remembering that that same thing is true of all of us in our spiritual lives. We must join wholeheartedly in the race that has been set before us, as Hebrews 12:1 says. Give ourselves more fully to God, remembering how fully He has given Himself to us. Let us pray. Blessed Heavenly Father, we thank You for the opportunity to be in Your house of prayer, to hear Your words, both encouraging and correcting. We ask, O Lord, we ask in the words of this man whose son was so afflicted, that we believe, help us in our unbelief. Strengthen us in our desire to be Your people. Strengthen our commitment to Your word and Your will and Your ways, so that we might bless others as we ourselves have been blessed. And we pray this in the powerful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.